Hello, and welcome to the environmental overview portion of the ReConnect application workshop.
I'd now like to introduce the presenters for today's session, Brian Smith, who is the GFR for Arizona and New Mexico, and David Krantz, who is the Forest Service NEPA guru and policy advisor. I'll turn it over to you, Brian.
Thanks, Taylor. Greatly appreciated. Today, we're going to spend some time talking about environmental, which has been a hot topic, and we're going to try and make it even hotter and more exciting for you today. So here's some of the things we're going to go over today. We're just going to do just an introduction and some updates. We're going to talk about some of the key changes from our fiscal year 2020 to the fiscal year 2022 funding opportunity announcement requirements. We're going to touch on some rural development environmental requirements, and then we're going to go through completing the environmental components that are in your application system, which would include the project tab and the environmental tab. We're going to talk about some post-award requirements, and we're going to discuss site and route descriptions. So I guess we'll kick it off. You can go ahead there, Taylor. Thank you. Some of the changes from 2020, submission on the projects maps or site plans that were required to identify cable routes, building locations, and tower locations or other equipment locations, and the structures that they involved. We had a default buffer originally of 75 feet, and that was causing some issues with bringing in stuff that really would have no impact in the project. So the default buffer was changed from 75 feet down to 25 feet. If you say you're on a four-lane highway and you don't know which side of the road you're going to be on, you would maybe want to extend that from the 25 feet. It's probably going to be it's probably going to work for most situations, but if it doesn't work for your situation or you think you're going to need more space than that, based upon the area, then you would go ahead and adjust that to the appropriate amount. We've been talking a lot about this time. We don't want you to start consultation on your project with other agencies related to environmental without first speaking to our US Telecom Division staff. You can reach out to us through the Contact Us link with any questions that you have, but we're probably going to tell you, we just don't want you to start if you do reach out. We've gotten a lot of questions that people kind of were thinking that maybe they should reach out just so they can go over the project. But what we're going to do is when you submit everything to us, we're actually going to review it all. And then we're going to take a look at it and have a meeting with the awardee should an award be issued. And then have a discussion based upon that. We wouldn't want you spending a bunch of money on environmental when you don't know if you're getting an award yet. And so it's best to have us review the project first and reach out to you. We're expanding the use of our categorical exclusion .53 in our regulation 1970.53. There's for no potential determinations. And we're not requiring initiation of coordination prior to application submission, as I kind of touched on there. The fiscal year 2022 funding opportunity announcement, some of the requirements were applicants must adhere to the federal environmental laws, statutes, regulations, and executive orders that are in our regulation, which is that 7 CFR 1970, and our required environmental authorizations. Those are related to NEPA, the NHPA, otherwise known as Section 106, the Endangered Species Acts, and a bunch of other laws and regulations. Applicants must provide completed environmental questionnaires. These include the site route questionnaire, the project questionnaire, and the Section 106 project questionnaire when you're in the application system. It's the applicant's responsibility to obtain all necessary federal, tribal, state, and local governmental permits and approvals necessary for the proposed work to be constructed. When you submit your application, we don't expect you to have started your permitting process. You know, if you want to call one of those agencies and have a meeting with them saying this is our project we're looking at doing, one of the things I would say is go and see if you're, say you have an existing right of way in that area, maybe you have a pole line, go and make sure that your permit is up to date. That's something that would be wise to do, because some of the work you're doing could just be considered maintenance, depending upon the agency you're working with. And we've come across a lot of those where it turns out that some of the permits were expired. This is especially true if maybe you're a telco and you're going on to, or an ISP and you're going on to electric cooperatives poles or electric companies poles. You want to make sure that their permits are up to date, because you might not be able to do anything at all if they haven't updated their permits. And then when you go to do your application, or say you get an award, you build out your project, you would want to make sure that those are up to date. And again, those often include maintenance agreements. I think Forest Service and some of the other agencies, they want them renewed after 5 years is what I've realized. And I can't remember for sure if it was Forest Service, but about 5 years they expire. So please do be cognizant of that. And also another thing too, is we've had a lot of questions if people can start the SF-299 permitting process with the federal agency if they're gonna cross federal lands. You can if you want to, but again, this is a competitively scored program. So just thinking from a outside perspective, I'm not sure you would want to spend money preparing permits and applying for permits if you didn't know if you were going to get the grant or not. But if you're comfortable doing that, or it doesn't involve a lot of cost to you, and that's something you want to go ahead and do, that would be your process. But again, we don't anticipate starting any environmental work until we've reviewed the application. As an applicant or an awardee, you would be required to cooperate with the granting agency in identifying any measures to reduce or avoid adverse environmental impacts. And we're also expanding the use of the National Programmatic Agreement authority under ReConnect as it applies. Here's some of our environmental regulations in case you're bored, or maybe it's late at night and you can't fall asleep, or you just love this stuff and you want to read it. 7 CFR 1970, if you Google that, it'll probably take you to what's called the ECFR, which is the Electronic Code of Federal Regulations. And some of the specific ones that seem to often apply to telecom projects is subpart B, which is the categorical exclusions, subpart H, which is section 106, and the NHPA, and the ESA or Endangered Species Act. The agency and all ReConnect applicants will comply with these regulations, as well as more than 40 other statutes, executive orders, and regulations applicable to the agency's programs. You, as the applicant, or in this case, it would be, I guess, the awardee, would be responsible for complying with the state and local regulations that you have in your area. Completing your environmental components of the application system is kind of what we're going to get into now. So we'll give you a little bit of information on this. When you get to your application navigation bar under your project section, there is a NEPA review hyperlink, which you can click on to get into it. When you get into this, you're going to see a screen that looks like this. It says rural development has identified classes of actions and the level of environmental review required for the proposals and agency actions. These questions have caught up a couple people. We've gotten some questions through our contact us on this, and I had a couple where people didn't really know how to answer this. It says right here, and this is where I think the confusion comes in. It says the proposed action one that rural development as identified as requiring an EIS, and the next one says for an EA. Obviously, we haven't reviewed your project yet, so we don't know if it's going to be identified as a EIS or an EA. So I've had a couple people reach out and they wanted some information on this. Well, honestly, we don't know. So, but if you know, or you think it's going to be for some certain reason, you could check yes, but most of the time, the answer is probably going to be no, unless you're in a very sensitive area, such as something with fiber going in the sea, or you have something, you know, in an area with polar bears or something like that would be some of the examples where we might have seen something like this. But if you don't, if there's nothing you're aware of that is causing it to be an EA or an EIS, you would check no for these. And then when we review the project, you know, we would let you know if there's something that we're seeing there. The next section is going to get into the construction map, which is actually under the environmental tab. So basically, when you're in that navigation bar again, you can click the construction map hyperlink, and then it'll take you to the construction map. And this is where you as the applicant would draw your sites and routes. This is not your PFSA map. So this is not the, you know, the previously uploaded area that you're serving in. This is really where you're gonna put in your routes. And I can't stress enough on this first bullet point that you're drawn, you should be drawing it as accurate as possible. So, you know, I had one that I was reviewing the other day with an awardee from the second round, and they were redrawing some routes, and they were trying to go more into existing right away. And we were looking at it, and I said, this one looks like it's going through a mountain. And they said, oh, well, that's not correct. It's just going all along the road. And so I said, well, if you give me a map, and you're drawn right here in your shapefile that is showing it's going through a mountain, then I'm gonna have to review this like it's going through a mountain. So, you know, we really need you to be as accurate as possible. You know, some people, I think they do it from a higher area, or they're zoomed out more or whatever it is when they make these. And that's really going to cause a problem, because we want it to be as accurate as possible down to what side of the road you anticipate on. And we know that that might change after your project is staked. We completely understand that. But we want something that we can approve, get your project going. If you have something that changes, that would be handled at a scope change after the initial approval. We have something in there called sites, and we have something called route. So a site would be a new or existing facility, and these would be a tower, a hut, or a cabinet. Those can go on pads. If you had something like that, we would not want it to be the entire area. We want to know what's actually being done. So, you know, we've had someone, well, I bought this, I have this 50-50 plot of land. And so they're putting in, you know, this plot of land, but actually the disturbance is only 10 by 15. We want to know what the disturbance is going to be. So think about that when you're designing those in the system. If you had any parking lots or access roads that you were having to create, those would go in there. If your routes, as I was saying in relation to the first bullet point, are basically the fiber being installed minus any service connections to subscribers. The maps can include various environmental resource layers. It has flood hazard zones, wetlands inventory, historic and cultural resources, critical habitats. We kind of have everything in the system so that it's going to kind of show you what's in there and kind of help you maybe even determining potential issues with your route. Next slide, please, Taylor. Your site and route descriptions, we're going to get in that a little bit more. When you get into the construction map, you basically go in and you have this pop up, and you can click on the site and route descriptions. Here is how you create and draw a site if you are not already to this place in your application. You click the menu in the top left corner of the construction map, which, as you can see up there, is three horizontal lines. Then you go down to the sites and routes table. And you go ahead, and the site and routes table displays in the top right of the screen, the sites and routes header. Basically, it can be collapsed as needed, but the table shrinks to the top right corner of the map and displays a globe icon. And you can expand it again by displaying that globe icon. This is how it's going to look when you go in there to add it. And as you can see, it has the little add site or route. Add those routes, and after you've added all the sites and routes, and the shapes have all been created via the construction maps, you have to enter a description for each site and route. Had a couple questions. People, I don't think they want to get into this, but I got to be really honest about it. The more detailed your site and route is, it's going to be better for your environmental review, because it helps us determine how much of an impact there actually is. So, you know, your site and route descriptions basically specify what type of facilities you're building, or if you're doing an upgrade at a location, and, you know, help us determine, you know, is it going to be on existing poles? Is it going to be new poles? Is it going to be buried? Is it existing buried cable there? But the big thing here is that you can't enter a description for a site and a route before it is created in the construction map. So there's not really a shortcut. You need to do these in order. And if you look at our application guide, it really will walk you through this quite closely. This section must be totally done before you can begin the environmental questionnaire or the EQ section, because as I said, when you provide this information, it'll determine what requirements you're going to need for the EQ section. So again, accuracy is key. Next slide, please. As I've been saying, I'll say it again, accuracy is and detail are key to an environmental approval. It makes it easier for us to determine what you're doing. Again, we have that meeting, and you know, we'll ask you questions that we don't have, but the more accurate accuracy and detail you can provide, the better. You should be creating multiple routes to delineate different technology types, installation methods, and right-of-way requirements. You must enter descriptions for each site, as I stated, and route once they've been created in your construction maps. The descriptions will specify the types of facility to be built or upgraded at location. So as it says there, the descriptions will be used along with the EQs to determine the anticipated environmental and regulatory impact from construction. So, you know, if we know that you're, you know, plowing direct conduit plowing cable, and you're doing, you know, a 3-inch, you know, trench, and you're dropping it in and then you're burying it immediately, you know, that gives us a little bit more information than, you know, just saying I've literally seen it where people say they're going to do a 10-foot trench, and we know that that's not very realistic. And telecom in most cases. So those are the kind of things that it pays to be accurate on. Again, the information in this section will determine the requirements of your EQ. So the extra time you spent here will save you time later. Next slide, please. On your route and description, this is a sample of what the route descriptions look like in the system. This is actual screenshot. And it asks you a few questions. Does it cross tribal lands? Well, you would see them in the tribal layer, so you'd be able to answer that question. Is it going to cross federally managed lands? And they're identified in the system as formally classified lands layer of the construction map. Yes or no. We have had some where some of the mapping that is used is not as accurate. If that's the case for something, you can provide additional details in the notes. We had one where it looked like the entire area was BLM land, but when you actually were able to get in quick, close enough, which our map didn't do, we were able to get some other information and show that that was actually a town and the area was not BLM land. And when you got in close enough, you could see that it actually around the town, the BLM area was. You check the boxes, which is, are applicable. Is this new, or are you upgrading or rebuilding existing telecommunications facilities? Now, the next question is really important. So it says, is the route in a previously developed existing right-of-way? Well, what isn't a previously developed existing right-of-way? That's any previously developed existing right-of-way. If it's been disturbed, that would be an existing right-of-way. So just because it might be new to you, if you're going on to someone else's poles, for example, that's an existing right-of-way. So that was, those boxes should be checked appropriately. What's your installation method? You have all the different choices there. How many miles? And then you put it in, you fill it out. Next slide, please. Your environmental tab and the environmental questionnaires. So here's what it kind of looks like when you get in there. Basically, it makes you right there that you check in the box because you have completed the construction map and the site and route descriptions. So very important again. The proposed actions identified in the site route and description section of this application have been determined to not have potential to cause effects to historic properties. Do not complete the Section 106 questionnaire or initiate the Section 106 process unless the Section 106 process has already been initiated with tribes, SHPOs, or other interested parties. So we want you to wait until we've issued an award and can assist you with this process. Next slide, please. The site route EQ, it captures the appropriate environmental information for each of your proposed sites and routes. Some things to keep in mind when you're completing these EQs, this is what is going to be reviewed for environmental. So your accuracy again is key. The information contained in the site route EQ needs to be consistent with what was in your construction map and your detailed site and route descriptions. The site and route EQs are based on the different layers that are contained within that construction map. So again, if you're not going through the mountain, don't put it going through the mountain because that can have an impact on your site and route EQs as well. When completing your EQs, you should ensure that the appropriate features and options are selected in your construction map. And any errors in the construction map are likely going to cause the EQs to be completed incorrectly, and it could lead to us finding an application ineligible. So again, accuracy is key. For your endangered species information, basically applicants need to do what we call a review of the official list of endangered species for each site or route completed. That's done for the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service IPAC planning tool. And when you go into the system, it basically allows you to, it kind of guides you to the planning tool. And what you can do is actually upload your items to it. So it was down, I think it's back up, but I understood we were having some problems. But if there is anything still going on, those are being addressed. You have to set up an account with Fish and Wildlife to do this. So, you know, make sure that, you know, you go and get your ducks in a row in order to have this stuff. We don't want you going to the next slide, please, Artilla. We don't want you to, all right, I was just to see if this touched on that again. This is fine. So we don't want you to go in there and complete all the steps. If you look at our guide, it actually tells you to complete the first step, which is how you get the initial list. We don't want you to spend the time continuing the process and fully consulting with them until we know that your project is, one, awarded. We don't want to waste their time. And two, that you need to proceed it, which we would be able to tell you after our review. A few things to keep in mind when your project, completing your project EQ. Again, the site and route EQs and reform the responses to the project EQs, and certain circumstances are going to require you to have multiple project EQs. For example, if a project had construction in two geographically unrelated areas with environmental impacts that were different in each location, you're going to have different EQs. If you have multiple service areas in an application, which is probably a good portion of the applications we see, applicants may need to fill out a project EQ for each service area if they are not contiguous or if they're just geographically dissimilar, and that's often the case for a lot of areas. Relating to the Section 106 EQ, the application system, it includes several validations that help to determine whether or not the application is going to require an NHPA Section 106 EQ. So if you're prompted to fill it out, It doesn't mean that you should start Section 106, but fill it out. And our U.S. telecom staff will reach out to you should you receive an award, and we will start going through the process with you. Something that you could upload that would be really helpful if you really wanted to get started on this, and you really wanted to just do something to get it going, would be a desktop or heritage review. We're kind of at the end of the time here, so I don't know if you'd be able to get it done before application, but that's something you could do. However, it's not required. We don't want you to have to have that burden of having extra costs prior to submitting an application. The EQ consists of Section 106 questions that will be used to review your application for environmental purposes. And we'll actually reach out to you, as it says there, and advise on starting Section 106 processes at the appropriate time. We will actually be responsible for initiating all the consultation through the awardee as applicable. So one of the things we found is some of those we reach out to, they want to be contacted by the federal agency that's involved in the project. They've worked with federal agencies. And so, a lot of the things that come from us help expedite the process. And if you just sent out letters now and, it's a 6 months or a year before they hear from you again, it might cause an issue. So we really want you to let us go ahead and do that and be there in the beginning to make sure everything goes the way that it should. Next slide, please. In the environmental documents subsection of the environmental tab, you can upload additional documents. So if you had that desktop review or a heritage review survey, sometimes referred to as a class one, you could upload it there. Maybe there's a project you've been planning for a while and you have that. Well, we can use that. So you can upload it there. You can download, view, delete, and replace all the documents that you previously uploaded. Maybe there's something in there after this webinar and you're like, why did I upload that? Or should I have put that in there? You can go back and view those, delete them, or remove them, or replace them as necessary. Again, it states there, I think we made this pretty clear now, that you should complete the construction map, the site and route descriptions, and the EQs before uploading any environmental documents as well. And again, a survey is not required, but a desktop review of the routes could be appropriate. We might ask you to do one for your project. So please be aware that that could happen. Or if you know you're going to be in a tribal area and you're confident that Section 106 is going to occur, that's something that we would you could feel free to go ahead and get started with. Next slide, please. There's a good chance that if we were to have a phone call with you and your project was to proceed, that we could reach out to you and ask you for some additional information. We had a couple projects that were submitted under the loans, and we've had calls on those already. We said, hey, we need some clarification on this and this, and those customers or potential awardees are working on that to see if they could get us that information to help with the environmental review. If additional information is required, your application is accepted for funding and the funds can be withheld by the agency under a special award condition requiring the awardee to submit additional environmental compliance information. So say you received the award and we're asking you for additional information to help complete the environmental. If we didn't get that for some reason, it's going to delay your project. And I think none of us want any of these projects to be delayed. We want to see them all moving forward. Some tips for success. As I've stated, basically be clear, identify and describe your sites and routes and the proposed method of construction on the map. We want you to be as accurate as possible. You need to be understanding and aware that what might be in your area for environmental and historic resources and how your project might impact those. You know your areas and you know where you're going, and you can add relevant information as appropriate. You need to determine whether your activities could avoid impacts to floodplains, wetlands, or other resources. If you know that There's an area that you've come across in the past and it's a sensitive area. If you can go to the other side of the road and avoid that area, then you know we would hope that that is something that you could do. And it might not be an issue from then on, or we could talk about it as a mitigant later on. You need to identify if the proposed project is going to require new rights of way, or if it can be built with an existing right of way. And again, that means a new right of way completely, not a previously disturbed right of way, which we would consider an existing right of way. Your environmental costs are in your budget and the pre-application expenses, and they are capped at 3% or pre-award and 3% post-award. And again, we don't want you to start Section 106 without any agency, anyone from the agency asking you to do so and being involved in that process. So please do not do that. If you are to receive an award, some of the things we would anticipate is that if there are deviations from the proposed project after you've staked it, that you would reach out to us. So we'd have what we call a scope change, and we've become pretty efficient at those. So, you know, say you had the project staked, we approved your project based upon what was submitted originally, and now you're going to go to the other side of the road, and that wasn't taken into consideration in the original review, or, you know, you're going to go in opposite direction to get around something or whatever the reason might be. We basically have you work with your general field representative to submit a scope change request, and then we get the documentation from you and we review those in conjunction with the actual scope change, which is something that is done through our engineering servicing division. Post-award, the environmental costs are like things like scope changes, studies, or monitoring. If additional information is required after your application is accepted for funding, again, funds could be withheld if you didn't comply with various aspects of environmental. We don't want anyone to get in trouble, and we take this very seriously, and we want to make sure that you're doing the right thing. Your route should be as narrow as realistically possible. As I said in the beginning, the default buffer was changed from 75 feet to 25 feet, which in my experience is pretty realistic to include the construction corridor. However, if you know it's a four-lane highway and you're not sure where you're going, you maybe could expand that to the appropriate amount. When you're creating your site, be sure to clarify the site disturbance. So, you know, as I was saying, if, you know, maybe you have a site that's, you know, a quarter acre or, you know, 100 by 100, but you had a building that was a prefab hut that you're putting on that site, and maybe, you know, you're only got a 20 by 10 or something like that that you're actually going to be working in, we would need to know the difference on that. And putting something more could cause your environmental review to be something more than it had to be. If you have an existing aerial route and it's not new, don't choose new poles. We had this on several applications, and it caused the environmental process to go into a little bit deeper than it had to, thinking that these were all new poles when actually it was just a new pole to the awardee and was an existing right of way actually for another company that owned the poles. If you're not clear on how to handle something, or if you're having an issue, you're not sure how to answer a question, we're here. We want to help you. We want to help you have the best application you can, and we want to make sure that this process goes as smoothly as possible. So hit the contact us button on the ReConnect website, and it goes through our system, and we will have someone who is specializing in that area to answer your question as quickly as possible. But the important thing is, we don't want you to guess. We don't want you to just put something in there that you're not sure about or you don't feel comfortable with, because it could cause your review to be delayed or cause issues further. We'd rather just have you have the right answer. Also, you know, the general field representatives are available as well. And You know, if we're getting down to the wire here, we're all going to be working a lot, and we want to try and get your questions answered as quickly as possible. But usually when we get to the end of these, questions can get delayed. So it's important to get in the system as soon as possible and let us help you answer any questions as soon as possible. Next slide, please. Some more stuff. Right-of-way could be an existing right-of-way. It could be a disturbed right-of-way, or it could be a new right-of-way. I think I've kind of beat that pretty good, but examples of an existing right-of-way would be wholly owned by the applicant with previously present infrastructure. Say you had old copper cable that you're replacing and you buried it there and you're just going right in the same area. Right away that is owned by another entity, such as an electric co-op, as I've said, if you're co-locating on that, that would be existing right away. If it's a roadside right away, you know, often there's existing water, sewer, lots of maintenance that's been done in the area. Sometimes we just need additional details or justifications in order to know that your project is not going to go deeper than the previous disturbance. So say there's sewer in the area, or water maybe would be, I know some areas, a lot of areas have septic, but they do have water. So say you had, you know, water in the area, and you know that it's there. Well, I mean, if you know the information or can get the information about how deep it is, and, you know, say that's 5 feet down or however far down it is, and we know that you're only going to go 36 inches down, you know, we know that your disturbance is not going to be more of a disturbance than already exists. Don't forget to account for construction areas. If you have sites or staging areas that you're going to be using, those would be important to know about as well. In most of the areas I'm in, you know, usually someone works until they can, and there's equipment's on the side of the road just the next day. So, but if you do have a staging area, that would be important to know. Next slide, please. Section 1970-53 is our categorical exclusions. These are actions that normally only require minimal environmental documentation as long as the agency doesn't find any potential or extraordinary circumstances. Actions in this section can be determined to require no further review under 36 CFR because they have no potential to cause effect. Actions in this section may be determined to have no effect to the listed, threatened, or endangered species. These are some of the actions under 1970-53. New utility service connections to individual users, or construction of utility lines or other components where you have no control over the placement of the facilities, such as drops to subscribers. If you're upgrading or rebuilding existing telecommunications infrastructure, that's another one. If you're burying new facilities for communication purposes and previously developed existing right-of-ways, as we've talked about, that is under the D2 section of 53. And then some other ones here are changes to electric transmission lines that involve pole replacement. We understand that sometimes, you know, if you're going co-locating, a pole might have to be replaced, and that's something that would be involved in your project because it has to compensate for the extra items going on there. Those would be covered under D3 or D5. A 54 is a categorical exclusion with a report, and I think I'm going to turn this section over to Dave if he's here, because he's going to be a little bit better at covering this stuff, I think.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Ryan. And hello, everyone. So, a little bit of background there on the .53s and the .54s. Differentiation really is basically the .53s are in existing disturbed areas, and your .54s are going to be in areas that are what I term as greenfield construction, that don't have existing utilities. It's not an existing right-of-way. It's a vegetated area or an area in its natural state. So that's the differentiation behind the scenes when you fill out these E2s that the environmental team will be looking at and how to process these actions. And the DOT54s are going to require, you'll be contacted by RD and their environmental staff to request some environmental reports on specific resources that are pertaining to this, the environmental checklist with the categorical exclusions, and we'll get into in a little bit. So here was just a brief kind of slide here of some of those categories that you'll see that you can use the DOT54s and still stay at a minimum level of environmental review, and so that you don't have to launch into an EA or an EIS. But all these activities do require disturbance to the ground that hasn't been disturbed before. And as you could imagine, that does require us to take a deeper dive or look at those resources and how your project could affect them. All right, we'll move ahead to the next one. So Brian, you know, I mean, as we work through this, this comes up a lot from you folks as GFRs, trying to figure out what are extraordinary circumstances, how are they triggered? And that first bullet is a really long run-on sentence that only, I guess, an attorney would like. It's hard to differentiate there what that really means. And for you folks, it's really the second bullet that you can focus on. And the reason why is because your actions are routine, they're non-complex, and the agency has seen these activities many times, and why we're into these categorical exclusions. And so we're really looking at these environmental resources on that checklist that correspond behind the scenes to your EQ. And Brian went over some of those, the NHPA, the ESA, and Clean Water Act when you're in floodplains or wetlands. So those are the types of things that we're going to look a little deeper into next. And who makes the call? You know, that's a question that folks will ask. Who decides what's an adverse effect? And that's really based on the record of information brought to the deciding official, the authorized officer, or the terminology used at USDA, I think it's agency official. So that's how it's determined. It's done through the environmental reports or the EQ and some work on our part behind the scenes. And we see if we trigger adverse effects. And if so, then we've got to beef up the analysis and launch into an EA or EIS. But there's good news out there. There's ways that we can mitigate those effects, avoid those effects, and keep you folks into these categorical exclusions so you can move through this process as smoothly and quickly as possible. All right, next slide, please. So we're going to look now at what I kind of have coined the big four of the checklist. And I didn't pick them in any particular order here, so this isn't the most important one, but we'll walk through each one of them. And this one is covering what's called formally classified lands. Really what you're looking at is land classifications. Are you, for instance, in a national forest? Is your project in Bureau of Land Management? Are you in a wildlife refuge, et cetera? Because each one of those designations come with statutory mandates for those land managers to manage those lands, whether it's a conservation perspective or a preservation mandate, or maybe something unique like a priority management mandate. And so it's important to understand where you're at on the landscape and what the hurdles may be to process. Now, here's the good news with that is in that EQ, Brian pointed out, you know, you may want to reach out to those land managers, and we call that the pre-application process. And that's a really good opportunity to learn from the land management agency what the process is to either amend your use that you already have an existing right-of-way, or maybe you need a new right-of-way, and you can look at the implications for the Endangered Species Act and your heritage consultations and even your NEPA documents, and we may be able to work together with that land management agency on that in a coordinated effort. So it's important to reach out to those folks and maybe provide some information on these EQs if you can, if you have time, that would help us help you in trying to coordinate those substantive environmental clearance procedures so that they're streamlined as much as possible. You know, and by doing this, we're creating expectations with timelines so you can be more informed on when to submit an application. For instance, maybe you'll find out, unfortunately, that environmental resource surveys are needed for certain species, and it could take over a year to complete those surveys. And so maybe you'll take a step back and say, gosh, with that known, maybe we'll pare down our project and work outside the forest, or maybe we'll submit it the following year. So working with those folks and having a better understanding of your timelines and considerations with those, what I call substantive laws, ESA, NHPA, et cetera. It can also help understand if there's a need for the land management agency to engage in a plan amendment. You know, we talk about these land use plans, and they're very similar to what a county has in county zoning. So these federally or formally classified lands will have requirements on what can be done in the way of construction. You know, the good news is if you got an existing right-of-way you're working in an existing disturbed area, then by default, it's an approved use. But you may be outside of one of those right-of-ways and you may need an amendment, and that can trigger a need for an EA or an EIS. And we can look at the level of complexity needed for that plan amendment, try to keep it to the minimum level and a minor amendment, and keep you folks into categorical exclusion. So let's move on to the next topic or the next resource, which is the ESA. And, you know, you really want to look at two parts of this. It's the most important is to answer a couple basic questions. You know, are there listed species and are you in designated critical habitat? And again, those land managers, if you're crossing federal lands, they're going to know more about that than you can probably glean from even ITAC. They're going to know some of the nuts and bolts on how that works. So those are important questions to ask them if you are crossing federal lands. But when you're in the ITAC system, you know, there's this spreadsheet that we ask you to do your best to fill out. And it may read like English, but it's very technical jargon for specialists in the biological arena. So if you've worked in an area before and you understand species effects and have done this before, it may be pretty easy for you to plug and play and move through this table. At other times, you may want to reach out to your GFR and get some assistance there if there's issues with species, home range, presence, or designated habitat. So those are things to look at. You know, Brian and I had discussed last time, maybe you don't jump in and get a qualified biologist to propose a finding. Initially, talk to your GFR. Maybe they've seen this before and have resources available to kind of get this moving forward. And so while the presumption is with the .53s that you're going to have no effect, you still have to do the due diligence here and walk through each one of these resources, like the Endangered Species Act, and see if there are any potential to cause effects to that species. Now, again, here's the good news about existing disturbed right-of-ways. Most of them are excluded from critical habitat. There's buffers off roadways and existing right-of-ways, typically 100 to 300 feet. So when Brian says you're working in 25 feet, maybe up to 75 feet, you should be in that buffer and not have downgrades to critical habitat. You still may have some avoidance strategies or timing strategies where there are presence of endangered species, but it's a lot less rigor than if you are creating a new right-of-way and affecting vegetation or other critical components of habitat. And again, like I said, there are programmatic agreements that Fish and Wildlife and NOAA Fisheries may have in place that can assist with the mitigation and project design strategies that we call, ESA calls them reasonable and prudent measures. and parts of the recovery actions for those listed species. So when you talk to a land manager, they may be able to say, oh yeah, we've got these agreements in place already with Fish and Wildlife, and these are the actions we would take to mitigate your effects to the species. And guess what? Those are still probably very valid off from federal lands if there's species present outside of the federal corridor. So it's a lot of good intel that you can get based on federal land management agencies and their exposure with working very technically with Fish and Wildlife and NOAA fisheries. So let's jump up to the next slide, wetlands. So wetlands come in two parts here. You have wetlands and floodplains that we're going to talk about and why the importance of looking at them through their respective lenses. The first matter of business here is the FEMA, under an executive order, reviews the floodplains, and the Clean Water Act is your primary jurisdiction for wetlands. Army Corps of Engineers is the main jurisdictional agency. There are some anomalies where you could have a state government or even a tribal government delegated authority for the Clean Water Act. So again, some subtle nuances to look at when you're dealing with floodplains and wetlands. The good news here is that most of your activities associated with broadband installation are not impactful on wetlands, although the first cut is to avoid. But if you can't avoid, do your due diligence and requisite research of these areas, but you can typically get what's called a national a permit or a general permit that exempts buried cables and aerial inserts so they don't trigger those extraordinary circumstances and still keep you into these categorical exclusions to move you through the process. So that's kind of it in a nutshell. When you're looking at the floodplains, you're looking at both parts of is it a good idea to build there? Is this infrastructure going to be destroyed by flood events, or am I going to mess with the hydrology? And it's there's not a lot of effect of your projects, but be as descriptive as you can if you have information, and let us know where you're passing through those floodplains, because our folks behind the scenes have a lot of knowledge that then they can walk this stuff through and get back to you if we need additional information. So the last topic we're going to jump into, we can jump up to the next slide, is the NHPA, the National Historic Preservation Act. And it has been, I guess, a little bit more time consuming than some of the other parts or components of the analysis, just in trying to get the surveys in place and come to an agreement on the types of surveys. So we call them heritage surveys, and Brian touched on that, that it is a good idea if you can to pull in any desktop analysis and alert us of any resource sensitivities there to heritage resources. You've got pre-Western heritage resources that are not always open and obvious to the eye because they're underneath the soil. And so it requires coordination with tribes and state historical preservation officers to ensure that we have an adequate understanding before we approve of a project and have compliance. So the good news here is your .53s, again, are in existing disturbed areas. There's very little risk of potential to affect. But we still need to take that requisite research and reasonable and good faith efforts to carry out appropriate identification of those resources. And that could require literature reviews or pedestrian surveys, that's, you know, walk in the area, or even what's called shovel tests, which is turning over a little dirt to look for areas where there's, you know, a high probability of resources. And so whatever you can bring in to help us understand the landscape out there and how the probability of finding these resources, it's going to help us move through the process quicker. And, you know, there could be some frustration because you may have had a project in the past and said, hey, well, we didn't have to do these surveys. Why are we doing it this time? And it's really case by case. It depends on the area and the level of resources that may be there. Are you in a heritage district or a historic district? So all of those components really play into what the agency official has to look at in the way of a reasonable and good faith effort to identify those resources ahead of time. You know, the good news is, Brian said, we're going to lean on that national programmatic agreement to get us out of the gates and get your funding while the surveys are completed. And there's even more good news that we can use a phased approach where we've got extensive project proposals with lots of miles of right-of-way, and we can even phase construction as we proceed with clearances. So it's called the clear and construct model. And it gives us the ability to move these projects forward. There is obviously some risk when you're doing that, because as you clear, you may find something that you can't clear and you have to avoid and redesign. So we will discuss with you what that means in the field during construction and how we can proceed through that. And again, the land management agencies have in place sometimes programmatic agreements that are of a different shade that work with tribes and SHPOs on approving certain types of activities. So again, reaching out when you're doing your formal classification of lands with those land management agencies, they can help you understand where you have the ability to move quicker in relationship to some of these resources. So that's kind of it in a nutshell. Kind of want to cover these, but encourage some Q&As coming in and we can talk a little bit more about them. And we'll move on to the next slide, which is just kind of the helpful list of resources out there for you. A bunch of hot links there that can direct you into various parts of the environmental process and can help you through this. I'll hand it back to Brian. And we'll go from there.
All right. Yeah. So as Dave said, this is thanks, Dave, by the way, for adding information. I gave it to you one slide too soon there.
That's
so
okay.
I apologize for that. But I kind of thought, you know, Dave could explain a 54 better than I could. So our regulation for environmental is listed there. That's the first one. That's the ECFR for that, which is a great way to look up anything using the ECFRs. The next one there is our application guide. Most of the questions that I've come across as a GFR or when I'm handling cases in a system, I pull up the application guide and hit Control F, and I find whatever the topic is. And, 99% of the questions that we get actually could be answered in the application guide, which is extremely robust. It's 273 pages. So it's very well done. I'm very impressed with it. Upcoming events is another one we have. We're kind of at the end of the time here for ReConnect, but if we choose to hold anything else or future events, they were listed right there at that usda.gov/reconnect events. And pretty much anything you could get to related to ReConnect is on that ReConnect resources page. If you scroll down, you'll see a couple different tabs that take you to the different areas that are of high importance, and as well as that, it has the fact sheets and FAQs. The contact us link is on there as well, and you could use that to ask any questions you have. And then we also have a rural development e-connectivity toolkit that's available, which you can get with that link, usda.gov/broadband. And then of course the awesome GFRs are available to assist you as well. And if you click on that link with the GFR, the first one there, you can find out who the GFR for your state is. And then as well as that, there's also state offices. They don't do these programs, but they do a lot of programs. Rural Development has over 40 programs, everything from sewer and wastewater to business programs to community development projects to housing. So we could basically build a city or community with all our programs that's in a rural area. So reach out to them if you have anything else on that. And with that, I guess we'll get to the questions. And James was going to handle those. So James, why don't you go ahead and open it up?
All right. Thank you, Brian. You all did an excellent job We've got a few questions in now. We encourage anybody to go ahead and submit any questions that they may have regarding the environmental process. So Andrew has a couple of questions. Do the route maps need to have been entered twice? After the PFSA entry, there is a network diagram where we freehand map or upload our fiber route deployments. Do we need to do it again under the construction map section as network design section versus the construction map section? So I'll take this one. So under the network tab, where it talks about the network design, there you enter in a description of the network, existing network, proposed network, and then you upload network diagrams, an existing network diagram and a proposed network diagram. It's not necessarily drawn in the mapping software. It's more of the document uploaded that there are documents that highlight your existing network, the configuration thereof, includes possibly some physical addresses or lat-long coordinates of larger network elements, sites, that. The actual construction map, I'll let Brian talk about. That's where you're doing the actual design in and laying it out on the mapping tool inside the ReConnect software application intake system. Brian, you can talk a little bit about putting the map, the design in the construction map section where you're filling out the EQs.
Yeah, and so, you know, Andrew, if you were to take a look at the application guide, it goes into it. There's an entire section in there related to that. I think it starts on about page 40, and it helps you to draw. It talks about all the different elements of drawing your construction map. And the construction map is actually drawn first before the, in the system, the way it's laid out. You would be doing your construction map prior to doing the network design. So you would do that first. And again, that would lend to later questions that you would receive under the environmental that were related to that construction map. So, you know, the network design, as James said, is more technical aspects of it. The construction map is location aspects related to what you're going to be doing. So hopefully that helps clarify.
All right. Thank you, Brian. And then Andrew also asked, if we are submitting 10 PFSAs that are not contiguous, does each PFSA require its own EQ?
More than likely, the answer would be yes. It's going to require its own EQ. I think your best bet is to plan for that and do it that way. Because as Dave was speaking to, there's a chance that maybe there's some parts of your project that don't require as high a level of review as others. And so you would be doing yourself a disservice if you tried to upload them as one EQ and you would be capturing things that might not apply to the entire project, and therefore the whole project could be delayed instead of maybe doing something like a phased approach to your project, which would allow us to release the project and construction to start in areas where it was cleared. So that's why that's so important and crucial.
All right. So Joseph has asked, are amounts of the environmental limited to 3% pre-award and 5% total? One of the slides he saw says it was 3% plus 3%, which is it?
Well, that's a great question. And I get a little confused about this myself. So I'm going to tell you how I understand it. And if someone else has something to add, they can speak up on this. Your 3% pre-award, there's 5% total pre-award or pre-application expenses. 3% of those application expenses can include environmental. I would recommend that you make sure that 3% of them does include environmental. If you have savings somewhere else, you might be able to transfer those through a budget reallocation request if that happens. And you know, something else might go up, like fiber might become more expensive. But Joseph, I think we've spoken, and I know that your project could probably have higher environmental costs. The 3% on the back end, is something that was allowed for monitoring or other issues that could come up that might be related to something that's done post clearance, or if you were to receive a partial clearance. So it's not exactly for just general environmental stuff. It's more of something that would need to be done. Say that you're working in a tribal area, which I think your project was in, and they wanted you to do monitoring. That's something that could be used for that. So that's something to be aware of.
Excellent, Brian. So how can we know that actions may be determined to have no effect on listed, threatened, or endangered species?
You may not know. That's why we want you to give us the information by getting the list, and you would basically provide it to us, and we'd be able to review the project in accordance with that list. And we would probably, if we have to, ask for additional information. We may have you continue on with the consultation process. I thought maybe, Dave, you could give some background on that one, a little bit about how that all works, if you want to get into the nitty gritty on it.
Yeah. I mean, you're spot on. The idea is make your best case with the information that's, you know, based in science, logic, and reason to say why it's not going to affect the species. And it could be an avoidance strategy that's been tried before, and we know from past actions that we will agree and buy off on it. There could be more complexity to the mitigation, which could require on our end reviewing that in informal consultation with Fish and Wildlife. So it's a collaborative effort. And at the end of the day, the jurisdictional agency will make that call. And if it's a no effect call, then it is USDA that would make the call with informal consultation with Fish and Wildlife. If in fact there is a need for formal consultation, then the jurisdiction hands over to the ESA agency, which would either be Fish and Wildlife or NOAA Fisheries, based on their science and biological research. So it depends on the level and scrutiny, but I think the best thing that you can do is provide as much information and evidence to support your initial call. And if it, like I said, if it's standard mitigation that we've seen before, these are routine actions, we can walk through it pretty quickly. But if these are novel or new ideas or concepts, then it may take a little more thought process and reaching out to Fish and Wildlife to come to that conclusion.
Perfect. And, you know, another thing I'll add, an example would be maybe something, and you can correct me if I'm wrong. Say you have some type of, I don't know, I think in New Mexico, it's the sage grouse that they have, and there are certain years that are mating season. And so basically no construction can be done during that time in certain areas because they're known to have mating season during that area. And so that was, I think, one that we used to encounter.
Correct. So something like that. It's their lek. I mean, that's their mating area is called a lek. And what happens is the noise disturbs their mating rituals, and essentially they can't hear each other. And so the males can't drum loud enough to bring in the females. So yeah, and that's a very important biological function, obviously, for that species to exist and persist, I should say. And so that's the important thing. Yes, and so these are ideas that are concrete into programmatic agreements that agencies have worked out behind the scenes with Fish and Wildlife as a way to reduce your effects and get to a no effect call on a species.
And something I might add, seen in the past, that is a good thing. So if you are, you know, one of the proposed construction round is going through an area where there is a concern over a plant, an endangered plant. However, you know that right away that you will be putting your facilities down is continuously mowed by, you know, state, county forces. Probably would be good to make mention of that in the EQs so that everyone's aware that, you know, this situation is actually exist where may not be likely to impact it because other circumstances are occurring.
Great point, James. Yeah, plants. And that example hit the nail on the head on how you deal with an existing right-of-way that has heavily disturbance. And there's buy-off with Fish and Wildlife Service that those areas, like I said, are excluded from critical habitat. They're non-high priority sites based on the amount of disturbance that's going to continue to occur there. Correct. So notifying us of that will help us move it through more smoothly.
All right. Andrew has asked a question. If we meet the criteria of not to upload our existing infrastructure NFSAs, do we need to upload our existing network / trunking in any areas for environmental review?
If you were putting equipment that was being used for both, I would put it in there. If it's not anything to do with the new equipment going in, then I would say you would not need to do it. So if it's you know, completely unrelated, you're not gonna, it's not gonna be, the new stuff you're putting is not dependent on some of that equipment, then it would not be an issue. If it, you know, would be, what's that word I'm thinking of, James, with the equipment when it's used for two purposes? What do we call that again?
Prorated, if it's going to be prorated and it's being utilized for
both networks, basically.
Yeah, both. NFSA's funding, you know, are serving an area that's not under the ReConnect application, or for a PFSA, then we will facility, it's common network facility.
There we go, common network facility. That's right. So we would want to know where that equipment was or whatever and that site was. We would need to know basically the unrelated fiber or whatever, but we would need to know the equipment that is a common network equipment.
So, Brian or Dave, in order to complete the endangered species list, is it necessary to go the quote unquote defined project process to complete the special status plant and wildlife species table, and how long does it take to define it? I think that sort of is referencing, you know, if you look at the IPAC, there's a 4-step process that generates official letter. Is it necessary to go that complete route
That's a great question. And actually you and I talked about that about a week or so, I think, James. Mm-hmm. And we what we were talking about is that really step one is what you need to do. You do step one and then the system generates, and I don't know if Dave can comment on how long it takes to get the thing, but my understanding is it doesn't take that long from my experience to get that list, and then it generates that list. And you can go back, I think 20 minutes or 30 minutes, I don't know, this exact amount of time, because usually I'm doing something else. But you go back in there, but we don't want you to spend time, you know, going down the full route and taking up the Forest Service's resources for something that we need to review first anyways. So if you complete step one and then you go back and you get that list, you can upload it into the system.
Yeah, I don't have much to add to that, Brian, because I've not went to the IPAC site. I mean, typically with BLM and the Forest Service, we have our specialists that do that. But it sounds like, yes, that you would just do the preliminary review, that first step that would kind of pull in information on existence of species and critical habitat. I think that's what's going to come out of that. But yeah, as you go deeper into it, it sounds like it's a very specialized tool. I do know that. And that's why we have trained biologists that go and perform those additional steps. So it sounds like you kind of do a cursory look here and provide the best amount of information you can on this spreadsheet, but it is a very technical guide. So reach out to your GFRs if you're having some stumbling blocks on filling it out.
Okay, so question list, we've exhausted that. Be happy for anybody else. Now's the time. You've got two experts around the table, so to speak. So any further questions, please enter those in the Q&A. Brian or Dave, while we're waiting on additional questions, do you all have any you know, any other ideas of, you know, common errors or some things you've seen that probably wouldn't be best practice for submitting an application, or some suggestions on what an applicant should be looking at including in there to make the environmental process go smoother.
You know, it's something just a general thing more so about the entire process, but, you know, I talked to someone the other day and they were going to submit an application this round. And they said they had everything done already. And then they told me they hadn't gotten in the system yet. And I was a little scared because, you know, there's a lot of different aspects to the system. And so if you haven't been in the system, you need to get in there as soon as possible so that you can get a feel for how it works. There's several checks and balances that are in the system. So if you don't complete one section, it could prevent you from submitting your application. So you want to be able to get in there and give yourself enough time to work everything out. And, you know, when it comes to the environmental specifically, being as accurate as possible is probably hands down the biggest thing and the best thing that you can do for your project in order to make sure that it goes as smoothly as possible. Accuracy and detail, I can't underscore it enough. We want to be able to handle your project quickly and efficiently, and we understand that projects change due to various reasons, and we can handle those as a scope change later on if they do change. But just, you know, don't start Section 106. Let us be involved in that so we can make sure everything is done correctly and that we are you know, giving you the best ability to move the project forward as quickly as possible. But other than that, I mean, I think I kind of touched on everything else. Dave, you have any additional words of wisdom?
Gosh, you know, you pretty much hit on everything that I would cover as well. It's building trust and rapport with everyone involved in the process and being above board and being flexible with mitigation and looking at scope changes realistically on the move as things kind of come into a more clear lens. The frustration is with the environmental process in general. It's what I would describe as iterative, which means it's back and forth. And your application process is more linear. So it kind of creates an inherent conflict in the process. And that's why I say trust is really important, to build that trust and rapport with all the agencies that are involved in the permitting process and be prepared for that iterative kind of connotation when you get into the environmental arena. I think that, you know, sometimes the tensions get high there with an application process that's more, you know, from A to Z, and you don't want to take a step back. And I completely understand. But as we illuminate things in the environmental process, we may have to make adjustments. And so try our best to, you know, light the environmental cave and see all the, you know, pitfalls in advance. That's a great notion, but it's really hard to do. And I understand the frustration, and, you know, we are here to help as much as possible behind the scenes to accommodate that and make it as streamlined, as efficient as possible.
Well, thank you, Dave, for that. And James, thanks for, you know, helping moderate the Q&A and for your additional input coming from that engineering perspective is always extremely useful. And Dave, with your experience, it's greatly appreciated. Again, if you have any additional questions, please reach out through the contact us or to your GFR. And with that, I'm going to wrap things up, and I'm going to turn it over to the Deputy Assistant Administrator of the Loan and Origination and Approval Division, and that is Mr. Randall Millhiser.
So congratulations, everybody. You have made it to the end of the workshop. I know it has been a lot of information. There's probably information overload at this point because, you know, we've gone over a lot in the past 3 days. And like I mentioned yesterday, we recognize that this application process is complicated and arduous and requires, you know, a lot of work to get one through. We've tried to make it beneficial to you. And I think we've tried to explain it in a manner that, you know, that would best suit your needs and move forward. And of course, we mentioned numerous times throughout the process that, you know, you should reach out to your GFRs, or you can reach out to, you know, RUS, or you can submit questions, and we're more than happy to help you, because we want to see you succeed. Also, like I mentioned yesterday, it's important to us that, you know, that this program is a success, and that we get as much, you know, broadband out to rural America as we can. And we started this morning with, you know, introducing you to some of our federal partners. We thought to make you aware of some of the other funding opportunities that are out there. I think their information is posted on our website from the webinars. And so if you have any questions or want to reach out to them, you can go to our website and get a contact, and then see if there's one of their programs that they offer that would also, you know, help you. In the breakout sessions this afternoon, we had two on the financial compliance, which is part of the award process. There is a reporting component that goes to winning these awards that, you know, you were expected to be reporting after you get your award, and reporting most likely quarterly going forward on some reports, and annually on some reports. Now, the reporting and compliance, when they're submitted, are reviewed by our servicing division. And as Brian mentioned, we're in the loan origination and approval division. So we will review and approve the loans and grants. But once we finish that part, they are handed off to the servicing division for servicing, making the advances, reviewing compliance, and things of that nature. So the caveat about the compliance, that if you don't file your compliance on time, then it could hold up some of your advances. So you want to be sure you're timely with those. And again, if you have any problem with those, sometimes the first one or two can be a little bit confusing, but you know, you can reach out to us, and we'll help you, you know, get off on the right foot. John Holman this afternoon reviewed the public notice filing, public notice response process. This is an integral part of the application process. Obviously, we don't want to invest in an area that already has sufficient broadband in its area. We take this part, you know, quite seriously. If anybody files a public notice response, we are going to take a look at it, and we will send GFRs out to do a service area validation process. I think any of you that have worked with us before sort of understand the service area validation process, that it's a boots on the ground process to determine what service is available in your PFSA, and if there's anything that meets the broadband speed that we have listed in the four of 120, which would possibly make the area ineligible. So that's a pretty complicated process, and it's very time consuming. So we do pay a lot of attention to that. So in the end, that we want to be sure that we're servicing an area that is not already being served. And finally, you know, we went over the environmental process, which Brian and Dave went over this afternoon, just completed. They did a very good process, got very good review on that. That is a complicated process. It can be a little murky. I think a couple of things that came out of the presentation would certainly be detail in your environmental questionnaire. Don't start the 106 process unless you ask your GFR or somebody in the environmental division to, if you should submit that, because once you submit your 106 process, you can't unring that bell. And so it really starts a series of events that takes time to get through. So we really don't want to go down that road unless we have to. So lastly, just one more time, we are here to help you. So please be sure to reach out if you need any help. We know it's a lot of work and we appreciate that. So with that being said, I think we can conclude today's workshop, and then we can we look forward to seeing your application come in, and we wish you all the best success. Thank you.